Heart to Heart tonight. Arkansas Heart Hospital is proud to bring you our Facebook Live session tonight, where we will be discussing fact or fiction for cardiovascular disease. My name is Vicki Wingfield, and I'll be your moderator tonight. Thank you for joining us. So right now, let me introduce tonight's esteemed panel of experts. Down here on the end, we have Dr. Michael Loguidice. He is electrophysiology cardiologist. Next to him is Brittany Lanier. Brittany is exercise physiologist from our Strong Hearts Cardiac Rehab Program. And Dr. P.J. Flaherty, sitting right next to me, and he's an interventional cardiologist. Thank each of you for joining us tonight. We're glad you're here. We're looking forward to what you're going to share with our audience tonight. I think it's going to be some fun.
Thanks for having us.
So let's get some of our beliefs regarding cardiovascular disease are many. We have lots of resources and places we get that information from, and sometimes you just don't know. Is this real? Is this true? Is it fact or fiction? So we're going to find out. So before I do that, I want to just talk to you a minute about each of our panelists. Dr. Loguidice, he's our electrophysiology cardiologist. So Dr. Loguidice treats heart rhythm disorders, atrial fib, heartbeat too fast, heartbeat too slow, tachycardia, pacemakers. We call him the electrician of the heart. Dr. Loguidice grew up in Pennsylvania, and he joined Heart Hospital just about a year ago. So congratulations on making it a year with us. We are glad you've been part of the team, and I know that you're building quite a practice here, and we're glad you're here. Brittany Lanier, right next to the good doctor, is our expert in exercise and lifestyle changes for the cardiovascular patient. You will have her on your care team. If you go through our cardiac rehab program, Brittany will be your favorite cheerleader. Then we've got Dr. P.J. Flaherty. What do I say about you, sir?
I can only imagine.
Dr. Flaherty treats all aspects of diagnostic and interventional cardiology, blockages, peripheral, coronary, nuclear, echo, CT angiography. We call Dr. Flaherty the plumber of the heart. Mm-hmm. Dr. Flaherty grew up in Pittsburgh. He came to us by way of the Army.
That's right.
And he's been with us about 18 years, and we've been thrilled to have him as part of our team. So now we're going to get to it. Fact or fiction panel. There's so much information that we have. Sometimes it can be overwhelming. Sometimes we hear things like eggs are good for us or eggs are bad for us. Sometimes they tell us we need to exercise every day, or maybe it's just 30 minutes three times a week. So we have asked our panel to help us weigh in tonight with their answers on what is fact or fiction. So before we get started, please feel free to submit questions in our live chat. We will get to all of those that we can. We have this great little basket right here that we'll be giving away at the end of our time together tonight. We'll draw a name from everyone who has sent us questions over the last couple of weeks and tonight. So panel, are you ready?
Fire away.
All right, here we go. So I'm gonna start with a really easy one. And Dr. Loguidice, I'm gonna start with you. So red wine, good for your heart, fact or fiction?
I think in moderation, wine is can be okay for the heart. I don't know that we have any good evidence to suggest that if you drink wine, you're just gonna live a lot longer. There is an idea out there that red wine may be the answer. You know, move to Tuscany, drink some red wine, and that's the answer to a long, healthy heart. But I don't know. There's enough data that I've seen to recommend my patients to just drink red wine and you'll be good. I think if you know you drink some wine in moderation, there seems to be and that maybe five glasses of wine a week at maximum, you know, there's no signal for harm. So,
gotcha. Thank you. I'm going to keep going a little bit with you, Dr. Loguidice. So some sources say that a vegetarian diet's better for your heart than one with animal protein. Fact or fiction?
Well, that depends. you know, certainly I know certain vegetarian diets that are high in saturated fats, high in fried foods. So if you have, for instance, if you eat a diet that's not vegetarian and you bake a chicken, you know, chicken breast, mm-hmm. that's relatively healthy, even though it's not vegetarian. But if you have cheese fries, you know, that's vegetarian, and that's not healthy. So I think it all depends. I routinely recommend my patients have a Mediterranean diet. I think the evidence that I've seen is strongest for that, and I always, and that's the diet I eat. So,
yeah. Brittany, how do you weigh in on that with regard to our cardiac rehab patients? What do you recommend for our cardiac rehab folks?
So for our patients, we recommend low sodium and low fat in their diet usually. With that, a lot of patients get scared about the low sodium and the low fat, but there are some foods that you can eat that taste just as good without the salt in them.
There are always foods that taste just a little bit better without salt. I haven't found a lot of them yet, but I'm sure it's true. So, Dr. Flaherty, if you take a cholesterol-lowering drug, you can eat anything you like. Fact or fiction?
Yeah, that's pretty clearly fiction on that, and I think that was a bit of a setup off of the last conversation that we were just having here. I mean, the cholesterol medications are really just part of the overall plan, and anytime you have cholesterol management issues that require a prescription for that management. I mean, you're gonna have some that are being put on it for primary prevention and initial events, and some that are being managed with for secondary prevention of follow-up problems that have already been established. But that's just part of the plan. And so you really kind of need to stick to the things like what we just heard regarding maintaining a healthy diet overall. So you can't just go down to your local, you know, cheesesteak shop and say I'm covered, because it's much bigger picture than that. It really requires a comprehensive, you know, multidisciplinary attack on the problem at hand.
There are a lot of things we need to be doing to make sure we maintain our good heart health, aren't there?
That's correct.
I'm going to stick with you for just a minute, Dr. Flaherty, and you've got some real past experience with this question. So vaping is less harmful than smoking, fact or fiction?
Well, the short answer to that is that we aren't sure. You know, vaping came out in headlines several years ago as being potentially a safe alternative to smoking. And certainly it's got some things that could be viewed as benefits. And we had some former Surgeon Generals of the United States that were part of the marketing teams for some of the big tobacco companies that are now owners of some of the vaping companies. I think over time we've seen that is a much bigger question that we don't really have at hand. There have been some unrecognized or unrecognizable pulmonary complications that can arise from vaping. Popcorn lung being one of them, which was originally described not because of the fact that the lungs or the alveoli in the lungs look like popcorn, but it was because it was similar to a issue that was identified in workers of the Orville Redenbacher popcorn plants years ago. And so that being one of them, but we really don't know what it means to long-term health regarding the inhalants that are, you know, native to vaping, you know, propylene glycol being one of them. That's the theater fog that, you know, you'll see on any Beyonce video. That we don't know what superheating that to the point of being able to vaporize it and inhale it really means. We don't know what it means to superheat the filaments in the whichever vaping apparatus that you're using. So that's a tricky, complex story. One thing to point out is that Juul did just this week lose their FDA marketing authority. Wow. So this is going to be a process and a project in development over probably the next several years.
So a lot of unknowns when we get down to vaping.
Absolutely.
Good deal. Dr. Luguidice, I'm too young to worry about heart disease. Fact or fiction?
Clearly fiction. The cardiovascular disease doesn't care about your age. We touched on a few things in terms of lifestyle, poor diet and a sedentary lifestyle. Those can set you up regardless of how young you are for cardiovascular disease. Genetics plays a huge role, and other health conditions like diabetes. You can have type 1 diabetes and mm-hmm. have heart disease at a very, very young age. So, yeah. I think knowing what your genetics is, what your family health is. I have a history of cardiovascular disease in my family, and I made sure I got my lipid panel checked when I was in my 20s, and got it. You know, I get it checked routinely just to cover my basis. Fiction.
Fiction. I agree. Dr. Luguidoche, I'm going to stick with you. We've got a couple of questions coming in from the live chat that may not be fact or fiction, but I'm going to throw them in the mix because people have questions and want to know. And this one's really right up your alley, sir. Does an AFib ablation work for getting off of blood pressure medications?
That's fiction.
That's fiction?
Yes. Atrial fibrillation ablation is an exciting, evolving technology that allows us to deliver liver energy to the heart for those hot spots in the heart that are responsible for triggering atrial fibrillation. It drastically reduces the burden of AFib over someone's lifetime. Doesn't cure it, but does drastically improve the quality of life. It doesn't, unfortunately, do anything for the blood pressure specifically. Those are different receptors, different areas. So,
Dr. Flaherty, following up on blood pressure, I would know if I had high blood pressure because there would be warning signs, fact or fiction?
Yeah, that's clearly fiction. And that's one of the reasons why, since seemingly the beginning of time, high blood pressure has been viewed as the silent killer. So people will walk around with blood pressures of 200 over 110 and know nothing about it until there's a complication. So this is one of those things that you really need to circle back around on with your physicians.
Right. Brittany, in cardiac rehab for your patients that come in, how many of them are you able to help with their blood pressure issues by lifestyle changes?
A majority of our patients we're able to help with by lifestyle changes. Just exercise and diet working together can help them so much with reducing that blood pressure.
That's great to know. Dr. Flaherty, coughing vigorously during a heart attack could save your life. Fact or fiction?
Okay. This one is one that that people will talk about because theoretically, if somebody's having a sudden cardiac event and they're in VFib or VT, ventricular tachycardia. I mean, we've talked about precordial thump as a means of cardioverting them. So specific to a heart attack, I don't think there's really any clear benefit on that one. For some other arrhythmias, certainly you can. Engage with a cough and break that arrhythmia, though.
Dr. Luguidoche, heart failure means that the heart stops beating. Fact or fiction?
Fiction. Yeah. Heart failure itself just means that there's not enough forward pumping of blood, and it usually manifests itself as shortness of breath, lung congestion, swelling in the lower extremities. The heart stopping is a totally different thing. We're talking about two different things. The heart stopping is more an electrical problem. Mm-hmm. So something that I treat, the heart can stop or quiver in ventricular fibrillation, like Dr. Flaherty was mentioning. That requires a different kind of treatment as opposed to slow heart rhythms, heart block, as we say, which require pacing. So that's heart stopping. Heart failure is a pump issue. It's not an efficient pumping of blood from the heart muscle.
Thank you. I wanted that question answered because I think just the name heart failure alone causes people to think that the heart fails and stops. And so I always like to make sure that we're explaining that to our community, that what heart failure truly is. So thank you for answering that. I hope you're enjoying these great answers. We're going to take a quick break. So go grab your popcorn. Make sure it's unsalted and unbuttered. Come right back for more Fact or Fiction.
There's nothing else quite like your heart. It can be bruised, even broken, but a heart can also heal in ways you never expected. There is strength in your heart, courage, and commitment that never gives up. Something this special deserves specialized care.
You do have a choice. Choose the only hospital in the region dedicated entirely to your heart, Arkansas Heart Hospital. why would our second hospital focus on bariatric surgery?
Encore Medical Center is home to our Bariatric and Metabolic Institute,
where we take a whole new approach.
Losing weight for heart health.
Here, we help patients reach their weight loss goals, reverse diabetes, and improve their quality of life.
Encore is our second act. Let's get started on yours.
Your heart is important. It's powerful, and it means everything.
You do have a choice. Choose the only hospital in the region dedicated entirely to your heart, Arkansas Heart Hospital.
If you are joining us right now, we want to welcome you back to our Heart to Heart Facebook Live session. Dr. Michael Laguidice, electrophysiology, cardiology, Brittany Lanier, our electrophysiology expert, and Dr. PJ Flaherty, our interventional cardiologist. So we've been having some good discussion, and we're going to continue on. Our next question is actually a question, and so I'm not going to phrase it as a fact or fiction. I'm just going to ask you, and somebody field it. I'm not going to even assign an answer. I'm going to throw it out there and watch you guys run for it. How do energy drinks affect the heart?
Well, sure.
It's yours.
You know, a lot of my patients come in with heart rhythm disorders, and one of the major triggers is energy drinks. Highly caffeinated pre-workouts as well, NO Explode, all those kind of energy drinks before workout, as well as Red Bull. Mountain Dew has a ton of caffeine in it. But there's a Monster. There's a ton of these energy drinks out there, and you know, they certainly are associated with certain heart arrhythmias and very symptomatic rhythms like atrial fibrillation, SVT, you know, and also they do increase the blood pressure as well. And in a lot of our patients who have cardiovascular disease, you know, we routinely don't recommend them. I don't recommend them to my patients. We know that coffee and, you know, under 80 milligrams and, you know, there's certain quantities of caffeine that are certainly okay. One or two cups of coffee a day is, if my patients with atrial fibrillation mm-hmm. want that, I allow them to have that because, you know, very small doses, mild to moderate amounts of caffeine are not associated with atrial fibrillation or PVCs or other heart rhythm disorders.
Good.
I'll jump in on a couple of things that came to mind as Mike was going through that stuff. A lot of this is volume dependent. So, I mean, you know, one or two of these things is probably not going to kill you, but, you know, you start drinking, you know, four or six of these things in a day, depending on, you know, what it is. I mean, most of these are coming in larger format vessels. The original Red Bulls were kind of tiny. Now you're seeing them in 20 plus ounce units. And so I think that the caffeine overdose is basically what we're seeing in a lot of this stuff. More importantly, the fact that you're feeling like you need an energy drink really means that you're probably needing hydration. And so most of these supplemented, you know, drinks that the people are going for, you could achieve the same goal by maintaining adequate hydration and not even needing it. The same goes true for a lot of the multi-level marketing supplements that are available that will have, you know, varying degrees of energy or weight loss claims and what have you. People will come in not knowing that they are consuming really high doses of caffeine. And in some of the older agents, even medications like ephedra, which are directly linked with issues as far as heart failure and those type of things.
Okay. Thanks, Dr. Flaherty. So I have another question, I'm gonna defer to you, sir. I'm active socially and happy, but overweight. Does being overweight put me at risk for heart disease?
That's a bit of a loaded question.
Yes, sir.
Because there is, you know, a certain population of people that are just never gonna develop coronary disease, regardless of how large they are. But in general, higher body mass index does carry with it the attendant risks of high blood pressure, you know, glycemic disorders that will eventually transition into diabetes, metabolic disorders that can be multifactorial, sleep apnea. The list goes kind of on and on. And so, you know, cholesterol management can be a problem in this capacity. So in general, really establishing early on a healthy lifestyle that will lead toward a more ideal body weight is likely to benefit all comers in that regard. It shouldn't go unnoticed that there's probably not a whole lot of 80-year-olds that are actually obese walking around. Most of those folks you'll see are smaller, thinner, you know, well-conditioned patients.
Brittany, in cardiac rehab, that's one of the, what I would call a byproduct of cardiac rehab, is that your patients tend to lose quite a bit of weight. Talk to us about the importance of that and how you get those patients to that point where they can drop those pounds if they've had a heart incident, and why we want them to do that.
So one of the things that we do at cardiac rehab, we also have a DEXA, where we can track the patient throughout the program from their initial eval to their discharge eval, because one of the things that we notice a lot of the patients will come to us and say is, I haven't lost weight. Sometimes you don't necessarily lose weight. Sometimes you lose inches, and then sometimes you gain muscle as well. So the DEXA is a good way for them to track, because some people are so focused on that number on the scale. As for weight loss, what we do is we bring the patient in for their initial eval. We go over what their goals are, because every patient's goals are different. Some patients want to work on muscle toning. Some patients want to work on balance, and some people just want to get back to their regular cardiovascular strength. So we try to combine the goals of the program, which are to work on strength, balance, training, cardiovascular fitness, along with the patient's goals, and along with diet as well, to get them the best results to help them lose weight.
Thank you, Brittany. Dr. Luguidice, do you have any thoughts on weight and how it would impact any of your patients?
Yeah, we know that weight loss after a PVI, or I guess before, is a beneficial thing. With weight loss usually comes a reduction in blood pressure, and with those two things, when we have a reduction in those, especially after, when I say PVI, I mean a pulmonary vein isolation, an atrial fibrillation ablation, we see less recurrence of the AFib, meaning that those lesions that I create are more durable, they last longer, patients' qualities of life is better. So with regards to heart rhythm disorders, specifically atrial fibrillation, if there is weight reduction, it leads to other, tremendous benefits, including lowering blood pressure, sometimes getting rid of diabetes, and all of this stuff, all of these things that we're mentioning can cause patients to do better from not even from a heart rhythm standpoint, just from a general quality of life and improved health.
Good. Thank you so much. One of our viewers has asked, and Dr. Flaherty, I'm going to let you take this one, is there danger in getting a nuclear stress test?
This is a common question that we get from our patients that are from the Nuclear One power plant, and a lot of them are radiation physicists, and so there's this inherent concern over radiation. In general, it does not deliver an amount of radiation that's going to have a meaningful impact on life. It's not something that we would view as being, a setup for radiation toxicity or anything like that. There are far higher doses of radiation that come from other unnecessary procedures that can be done on a repeated basis that's part of a separate discussion. But nuclear stress testing, either with technetium, which is part of our older protocols as far as nuclear imaging, or rubidium, which is our newer agent, those are not meaningful amounts of radiation that people ought to be concerned about.
Good, because there are a lot of people that is the only test they can do. They can't do a stress test because of backs or knees or things like that, so that could be an option for some people like that to do a nuclear instead.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, it's not like we're injecting radiation specifically. Right. We're using an agent that's going to tag the red blood cells so that we can follow them to the different areas of the heart that we can assess flow and function with.
Good. Thank you, sir. Brittany, I should avoid exercise after having a heart attack. Fact or fiction?
Fiction. It's always good, as long as your doctor advises it, like Dr. Levita J and Dr. Flaherty, it's always good to exercise. However, you need to pay attention to what kind of exercise that you're doing and not being too strenuous. And you also need to pay attention to your skeletal muscular system. If you know that you have knee problems or shoulder problems, it's probably not good for you to do heavy weights or things that involve your shoulders. Dr. Levita J or Dr. Flaherty can probably give a better answer as well.
I thought that was a pretty good answer, Brittany.
Yeah, I can't really think of anything to add there. I think, in general, exercise is going to be connected with better outcomes overall and probably increased life expectancy. So that's an important take-home point.
Brittany, I would ask you, how soon do you think a heart patient should exercise after a procedure?
So it depends on the procedure that they had and their doctor's recommendation. Usually we get a patient in anywhere from a week to 2 weeks after their procedure. We get them in and we start their initial eval process because it helps their recovery process a whole lot better.
Thank you. All right, I have another question from our watching audience. And thank you, audience, for being so good to send us questions. And this is one I'm going to just throw across the table and let you guys fight for it. Medical marijuana and the heart, good or bad?
So that's kind of a multi-layered issue here. We don't really have any good data one way or the other to look at on that. I will tell you that I don't, you know, if somebody's got some indication for medical marijuana, I don't generally discourage it. I don't prescribe it. But I'm not aware of anything that I can over my course of my career attribute, you know, to a marijuana related cardiac event, unless it was laced with something else, which if it's medical marijuana, it should not be laced with anything. So kind of by definition there, you should be getting, you know, straight from the source. Anything you're going to inhale is going to, you know, that's been lit is going to have, you know, an inflammatory response, such as cigarettes would do. But, you know, when you're talking about gummies and lollipops and those type of things, you're kind of working around all of that stuff. So for the rest and the remainder of the question, I don't know that we really have a strong answer on that.
Any comments, Dr. Laguida Che?
Yeah, I don't know. I have too much to add, but if someone will let me know, kind of, it's usually off the cuff at the end of the appointment that, you know, hey, I take medical marijuana. Is that okay for my AFib? My general response is, it's most likely not going to make it worse. You know, but you know, I encourage them to seek out those providers, keep in contact with those providers who are prescribing the medical marijuana, and do it in a safe way. And I don't tell a patient he or she is bad for doing it.
Okay.
But I don't know any data specifically on AFib or other heart rhythm disorders that it makes things worse.
Thank you. Dr. Flaherty, the pain in my legs must be a sign of aging. I'm sure it has nothing to do with my heart. Fact or fiction?
It's funny, this question came up in clinic either yesterday or today. I can't remember which it was, and somebody was trying to decide whether or not the pain in his right leg was related to vascular disease or if it was related to age. And the conversation went something like this, with the physician coming back after he had heard him. He said, well, it's probably just old age. And the patient looks at him and comes back and says, well, both of my legs are the same age and I have pain in this leg but not in this leg. So tell me how that factors in. So there's a lot of different things to take into consideration here. You know, vascular pain is pretty classic, exertional discomfort typically, although patients can have resting pain. Usually is worse starting in the feet, and then it will migrate up towards the hips if there's a vascular problem. Neuropathic pain, which is something that I think most diabetics have some familiarity with, at least in having it described to them, is more of a numbness and tingling type of phenomenon that again will typically start in the feet and then may migrate elsewhere. One important consideration is for lumbosacral low back pathology, because that is frequently misdiagnosed with it being a type of pain that will show up in the hip or the groin area and kind of wrap around the top of the thigh. That is typically not going to be a vascular or necessarily even a cardiac issue, and will require some further historical investigation. Usually that's stuff that will be worse with sitting for a prolonged period of time, and will actually get some relief when they get up and walk around. Now, if you've got established peripheral vascular disease, that is a red flag for vascular disease in general, and that could be kidneys, that could be heart, that could be carotid, that could be brain. It's all kind of a connected series of separate but related diagnoses. So we'll go ahead, once we see that somebody's got actually truly documented vascular disease, we'll go looking for the other things to play it safe.
Thank you. We're going to take another quick break. So if you want to salt your popcorn and butter it, go ahead. But come on back and join us in just a few minutes.
There's nothing else quite like your heart. It can be bruised, even broken, but a heart can also heal in ways you never expected. There is strength in your heart, courage, and commitment that never gives up. Something this special deserves specialized care.
You do have a choice. Choose the only hospital in the region dedicated entirely to your heart, Arkansas Heart Hospital.
Why would our second hospital focus on bariatric surgery?
Encore Medical Center is home to our Bariatric and Metabolic Institute,
where we take a whole new approach.
Losing weight for heart health.
Here, we help patients reach their weight loss goals, reverse diabetes, and improve their quality of life.
Encore is our second act. Let's get started on yours.
Your heart is important. It's powerful, and it means everything.
You do have a choice. Choose the only hospital in the region dedicated entirely to your heart, Arkansas Heart Hospital.
Welcome back. We are excited to continue our discussion tonight. Thanks for all of us, all of the viewers that have joined us tonight. So we're going to get back and hopefully extend out a little bit and take a few more of your questions. And I have another viewer question. Brittany, I'm going to start with you. And of course, Dr. Flaherty and Dr. Laguidache, please feel free to add whatever you like. So here's our question. I have a hard time breathing while exercising. Is this a sign of a weak heart? Also, are there exercises that will strengthen my heart?
Sometimes things in Dr. Laguidache or Dr. Flaherty can kind of fill in with this. It depends sometimes on what type of exercise they're doing and sometimes the climate that they're working out in as well. It's very hot and it's very humid outside, so I probably would need more information about what's going on and where they're exercising and what type of exercising they're actually doing.
Great. Let me throw in this. Some of our questions are really specific to people and what's going on with them, and that's great. We love those questions. Don't stop. But if we can't fully answer those questions, we will get back to you via email and give you a better explanation or a longer explanation. So don't let that stop you from asking a question. And if we don't answer your questions tonight, or ones that you've submitted already by on Facebook, we will provide those answers for you via email. So stay tuned if we don't get all of them. So fact or fiction, let's go with Dr. Flaherty. Vitamin supplements like CoQ10 can help your heart. Fact or fiction?
There's a lot of conflicting data on this specific topic, and this will get raised at our National American College of Cardiology meetings from time to time on the whole concept of nutraceuticals. Mm-hmm. So it's not pharmaceuticals that are, you know, targeted and managed by the FDA for specific indication, but it's nutraceuticals that will range from A to Z on what it is that you're trying to accomplish and what you're trying to treat. In general, less is more with the vitamin supplementation. And there's just current evolving new data on things like vitamin E not really having any benefit. That was something that we prescribed for quite a while back in the 90s. And data started to emerge then that vitamin E impacts from the diet were completely different than the vitamin E impacts from supplements. And you can go down a long list of things. But in general, the nutraceutical agents that we're talking about, vitamins and those type of things, really only serve the purpose of lining the pockets of the nutraceutical industry rather than any particular patient benefit, including CoQ10, which I will occasionally use if somebody's having a problem with resistant leg cramps when we're trying to initiate statin therapy and those type of things, but that's on a case-by-case basis that I would advise that.
Thank you. Dr. Luguidice, my heart is beating really fast. I must be having a heart attack. Fact or fiction?
That's fiction. You know, the level of exertion that that someone has really, and what the demands are in the body, how much oxygen needs to be supplied to the brain, to the organs, to the skeletal muscles, all depends on what you're doing. If you're training for, you know, if you have a young person training for a marathon and is out there running, trying to work on their on their splits and running an 800 meter, you know, the heart rate needs to be elevated. It's when you have a fast heart rate, when you are not having a normal level of exertion, that then we start to wonder what's going on here. Is it a primary heart rhythm disorder? Is it a signal of a heart attack? Probably not in the absence of chest pain or some other symptom that would suggest that a patient is having a heart attack. Most of the time when my patient tells me, hey boss, my heart rate is jacked, it's very high. What I typically will want to know is what you are doing, how long is it lasting for, and then we will usually assess for some heart rhythm disorder. And so a lot of times when someone does tell me that, we will look for a primary heart rhythm disorder, have a patient wear an ambulatory monitor, as opposed to immediately saying, hey, you know what, you're having a heart attack.
Thank you. Brittany, when talking about a heart attack, I know that when people come in for cardiac rehab, they're very nervous about getting back on that treadmill or doing any kind of exercise. How do we make that transition for our cardiac rehab patients, make them feel comfortable? What do we put in place that allows them to get back at exercise so that they're comfortable, to not fear that they're going to have another heart attack?
So one of the things that we do is, of course, we bring you in for that initial eval. That gives us time for you to honestly get to know us and us to get to know you. We want to know your medical history. We want to know what your goals are. We have a lot of patients who do come in and they're like, I'm nervous. I don't know what I can or I can't do. Mm-hmm. Our ultimate goal is to figure out what your needs are and to take it slow with you and to ease you into exercise so that hopefully near the end of our 12 to 18 week program that you're able to go out either on your own to do it at your own gym or at your own house, or come back to us, because with us your membership is free for the rest of your life if you just come back and exercise. So our ultimate goal is just to ease you into exercise and figure out what makes you the most comfortable. We never put you at any levels that do not work for you.
And I know that the team, you've got an RN there, you've got exercise physiologists, you have such a great team that really ensures the safety and comfort and confidence for our cardiac rehab patients. You guys do a great job.
Yes,
you really do.
Yeah, one important point to go along with that is that it's a very closely monitored setting. Mm-hmm. You've got basically a coach who knows your background, who is able to monitor you, look for signs of any problems that may be working their way into the situation, and can advise you when to back off. If something is needed to be adjusted, it can be made then and there. If you're gonna have a problem with initiating an exercise plan, it's best to do it in a monitored situation, at least initially. The other issue is that there are virtually no reasons as to why somebody can't participate in cardiac mm-hmm. rehab. If you're an amputee, even mm-hmm. a double amputee, there are things that you can benefit from a program like this. Arm exercises, arm bicycle exercises, all kinds of things that can be addressed. And then it just reinforces the lifestyle modification aspects of things that can be helped. So we've got a lot of people who will say, I can't do this or that. And we can almost always find a way around that.
That's great.
Yeah, if I can piggyback on that.
Yes, please.
There's not a lot of things in medicine where we're considered a bad doctor if we don't prescribe it. Cardiac rehab is one of those things where there's clear data, and you know our guidelines are pretty strong in that we should prescribe it. And you know, I think another thing to talk about, and we've alluded to this, is the psychological impact that a myocardial infarction or a heart attack has on a patient. You know, you're forced to confront your own mortality, and you don't know what to do. How far can I push this? Am I going to stress my heart till I have another heart attack? So I think easing into a regimen like cardiac rehab is a must. And we also know that depression goes along with having a myocardial infarction. And I think by allowing those natural endorphins to kick in with cardiac rehab, and because I've talked to my patients who are sedentary after a heart attack, and I think they do worse. They're miserable. And you get them out there, get into cardiac rehab, and they will fly, I think, better than if they just sit at home and don't do it. So,
yeah, grief is a very real thing after a heart attack, and there's no way to know that it's an issue unless you follow somebody regularly.
Yes.
And this is a perfect opportunity for folks to be able to identify that as being a problem, because there are stress hormones that are directly counterproductive and actually cardiac toxic. And if you can engage on those things early on, those are the times that you can really achieve the biggest benefit. And you got your own little built-in support group there, both of the people that are working there and then the peers around you that are also going through things that can kind of help you through those initial phases of doubt. More frequently, and might be able to offer you resources on other aspects of your life that you might be able to improve upon, such as grief counseling in another facility or arena. And those are things that are very important not to overlook.
And we do offer that as a part of our program. So not only do we focus on exercise and diet, we also focus on what happens afterwards and how the patient's feeling. We have Pastor Shelby who comes in and teaches workshops for us on a regular basis. Ms. Vicki, you've came in and talked to our patients on a regular basis. We have all the outlets. We have you guys do group settings, and we have one-on-one in case you're more comfortable talking to somebody one-on-one as well. So it's not just diet and exercise. It also encompasses the psychological part of it as well.
I like to think of our cardiac rehab as the whole package.
Yes.
I really do. Dr. Laguida Che, fact or fiction, AFib can be treated with medication.
That's a fact.
It can
be treated with medication. The data would suggest that medication plus ablation is the best way to control atrial fibrillation. And the reason for that is the mechanism of atrial fibrillation is so heterogeneous. There are triggers that cause someone to go into AFib from various hotspots, as I like to tell my patients. And those areas are suitable for an ablation and have been shown to, when you address them, drastically reduce the overall burden of atrial fibrillation in one's lifetime and thereby improving the quality of life. The one thing that the ablation does not do is it does not address the molecular changes that occur. We know that potassium and calcium levels are different in a patient with AFib. So the way that the heart is beating itself is different. And so when you have medications that affect the potassium and affect other things, other ions, whether it's sodium, potassium, or calcium, that addresses at a molecular level what's going on in atrial fibrillation. So I'm very upfront with my patients who've had two or three ablations sometimes, or even before any ablation, what the future entails with treatment, with medications alone or with ablations. Because if you only do one, you're not addressing the other.
Right.
So,
Can AFib be confused with another issue?
It can be. Atrial fibrillation, it doesn't have the classic presentation in most patients where it's, oh my goodness, my heart is 180 beats a minute and it's just pumping out of my chest. That's actually the rare case.
Okay.
The most common symptom is fatigue. Especially in our patients who are a little bit older and are dependent on what we call an atrial kick and AV synchrony, the atrium itself, the top chamber of the heart that is in atrial fibrillation, contributes a a good portion of the overall blood flow to the body, to the brain, to all the organs. So if you get rid of, I don't know, say a third of that blood flow, yeah, of course you're going to feel tired. You're going to feel short of breath.
Great. Thank you. Dr. Flaherty, heart catheterizations can cause permanent nerve damage. Fact or fiction?
As much as I want to say fiction, yes, there are instances in which that is something that needs to be addressed. And so we will rarely, I'm talking less than 1 in 10,000 cases, mm-hmm. we will have some neurologic issue that arises from usually the access site. Mm-hmm. So every artery has a vein and a nerve running next to it in a bundle, basically. And you know, it's no mystery that we have to go in and access these arteries with a needle. Mm-hmm. And if for whatever reason there's a problem with gaining control of the blood flow on the end of the procedure, where there might be a tremendous amount of inflammation, that can result in some, for our purposes, radial nerve injuries when we're managing that, or femoral nerve injuries. If somebody has a big vascular complication from that, it's usually not related to a primary neurologic injury. There's usually something else that's in play there that needs to be addressed further. But there are folks that will end up with some strange neurologic complication. It's usually some discomfort or neuropathic type of discomfort. It's usually not anything that's going to be like paralysis or anything like that. I mean, that would be a really, really odd one. There are some things that, you know, I have to follow personally and will occasionally, you know, require some further intervention.
Thank you. Heart disease is genetic and there's nothing I can do about it. Fact or fiction, Dr. Flaherty?
Well, that was a loaded question. So you can always do something about it. You know, genetics are just part of it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, everybody's going to get older, and with aging comes increasing risks. It just is part of the aging process. Genetics will usually predispose you to, you know, issues with cholesterol. We know that family considerations are that you usually either have a really, really high LDL or a really, really low HDL, which is your good cholesterol, that will be a setup for genetics. But you can manage these things. You can lower your cholesterol. You can get your glycemic or your diabetic control better managed. You can manage your blood pressure. You can actually impact, you know, weight loss and dealing with things that are problematic. We only have really 7 known cardiac risk factors, but we know that there are probably hundreds of others, a lot of which are environmental, that can, we don't know where the ignition switch and the key is. You know, sometimes you got to figure out where those is, and it all kind of comes together. We've got folks that have multiple cardiac risk factors and have no coronary disease, and we've got folks that have 1 or 2 that, you know, have tremendous coronary disease. Yeah, there is a family connection, but there's usually a common theme in that family, aside from just, hey, mom got it, so now I'm gonna have it. Mm-hmm. There's usually common themes of, you know, obesity, of smoking, of diabetes, of cholesterol issues, and those are the things that, you know, we're here to help you address. And so, yeah, there's always things that you can do about it.
Okay. You know, I think we're probably getting close to wrapping up, but before we do that, I would like each of you to, what is one thing that if you could really let your patients know or people know that you could communicate, what would that be? That the one thing that you think would be the biggest takeaway from tonight? Dr. LaGuida Chang, I'm going to start with you.
I think it's keep an open mind and to be inquisitive and inquiring. Not to always believe what you read and be open to learning new things, because a lot of the information that is out there and percolating in the stratosphere of social media can be false, but there's also a lot of good stuff out there. So I think bringing information in, I actually encourage my patients to come in with info. I like to see that. I like an engaged patient. If you don't have any questions, you don't have any questions. But if someone comes in with them, I mean, keep an open mind that, hey, maybe what you got, the information you got, isn't the truth. Maybe it is. But, you know, I think that's why we're here. Bring that information to us, and we can. That's what we're here for as physicians, is to guide you in the right direction, and we're happy to do that.
Thank you. Brittany, what would you like to share?
Exercise and diet working together can help give you the best results. I would also like to say that sometimes people get scared and they don't want to come to cardiac rehab because they think, oh, I've had that stent or I've had mm-hmm. something, so it's not going to affect me again. I'm feeling fine now. That's not always the case. As Dr. Flaherty and Dr. Lagudice had both said, we can monitor your heart rate. There's certain things that you can't do at home with just your Apple Watch or your Garmin. Mm, right. If you come to us, we have no problem with monitoring your heart rate and your blood pressure, so feel free to reach out.
Dr. Flaherty?
A couple of things, actually, but germane to this format and my patient clinic visits and those type of things, there's no question that's too small or too stupid. We're here to always help work through that information. Dr. Google is a dangerous doctor, and you have to be able to take that information and work with your healthcare professional, be it your family practice doctor, your cardiologist, whoever, to try and sift through the facts or fictions that are available out there, because there's a lot of really snake oil type of information that's available out there. And, you know, it's on us to help you identify those things, but we have to know what you're receiving as far as information before we can really address it proactively. In a similar vein, I want people to understand the issues that went on with the aspirin recommendations earlier in the year. This all started back in the fall when the U.S. Preventative Task Force started to release some guidelines that got leaked to the lay press about aspirin utilization. This all started back before the holidays, and it was not available to the medical community for commentary before the lay press started talking about it on places like the Today Show and that type of thing. And basically it came out with the conclusion that aspirin is bad. And that really was a poorly timed, poorly delivered message to the population as a whole, without separating out the issues with regard to primary prevention, where the benefit of the aspirin may be a little less clear, and secondary prevention for our established patients that have coronary disease, that have prior stents, that have had bypass surgery and those type of things. Those folks really are where the strong signal of benefit from aspirin and statins, for that matter, come into play. So lumping together everything, we've had patients by the dozens coming in asking, hey, should I still be on aspirin? Yeah. Why am I on this? Or are you trying to, you know, this, that, and the other with my health by keeping me on aspirin? And the answer to that question is, if you've got established coronary artery disease or some other pathology that we're following, and specifically if we've prescribed the aspirin, this is not something that should be intervened upon unilaterally without some further input from your family practice doctor or your cardiologist. And I will always give the family practice doctors first right of refusal on patients. It's imperative to have a good relationship with a family practice physician or a general internal medicine physician to address, you know, concerns early on, because we understand that it may take some time to work your way up to a cardiology visit.
Well, panel, you guys have been great. I've loved all your answers, some great information. I think we've probably busted a few myths out there. Maybe we've put Dr. Google out a little bit. I don't know. But hopefully we've provided some really great cardiovascular education for our Facebook audience tonight. So thank you for your time. I know you're busy, and I know it's the end of a long day, but thank you. Thank you for being with us tonight. Facebook audience, thank you for hanging with us for almost an hour. You guys rock. Thank you so much. We hope that you got your questions answered. If not, we'll try to get back with you with an email. And who won the basket? Joni Gatlin, thanks for great questions. We will be in touch with you on how you can have this wonderful little hat, some socks, some really great stuff in here. So with that, we're going to say good night. And stay tuned for our next Facebook Live. We are looking forward to another one. If you've got any questions, you can always go out to arheart.com for questions or contact information, and watch for our next Heart to Heart Facebook Live. And with that, we'll say good night. Thank you for coming out and visiting with us tonight.